candy.
Hey, and welcome to Penny Candy Interviews. And we are here with my friend, my good friend, my girlfriend, my girl, Sandra St. Victor in the house. Everybody, yay!
Hey.
The comparable but unfuckwithable. I always say she's like, there are people that try to sound like her. So it's the whole, you know, comparable thing. I'm not going to name names because I got a list. But
we're not going to do that, though.
We're not. We're going to act like adults today, which is new for us.
Yeah, that's a challenge.
Okay. So we just watched here on Penny Candy. We just watched the video for Chaka Khan's "Love of a Lifetime" and spotted a very young, very spry, very hungry Sandra St. Victor in the back. Now, you were back there with Mark Stevens, and who was the lady that was?
Cindy Meisel.
That was Cindy Meisel? Oh, okay. Yeah. I was looking at her face. I was like, who is this woman?
Yeah. She looks okay. Exactly the same as she does. Yeah.
She does. I don't know why I didn't recognize her face, but how did a Sandra St. Victor, first of all, let's start how you started working with Chaka, because I know y'all are like besties now, but like, how did it start? Because I know you were like doing stuff before her, but what made her say, that's the one I want?
Yeah, you know what, it was like an instant simpatico, because I was singing with Roy Ayers, touring with Roy sure. Ayers. Mm-hmm. And for some odd reason, whenever we came to New York to perform, he would like hardly let me sing. It was a very odd thing, and I still to this day don't really get it, because I'm not gonna talk ill of Uncle Roy, because Uncle Roy, sure. You know, but you know, whenever we got to New York, I got to play Shaker. Okay.
Oh, like, wow.
You know, and so we were playing at this club on Columbus Avenue and 70-some Street. It's called McKell's. I think that was McKell's, who we played usually in New York. And Chaka was at the bar.
Okay.
And for the show. And after, like, well, not even after the show, it was during the show, because I was hardly singing. I was always off stage. So I went backstage to let you know how long ago this shit was. There was a payphone backstage, and I went backstage to make a phone call. Jesus. Hello.
A payphone backstage? Okay.
Backstage. I can see it right now. I remember that moment. I'm on the phone talking to, I don't even remember who. And Chaka came because the bathroom was next to the payphone. And she came, she was going to the bathroom. She stopped. She said, hey. And I was like, let me call you back. That's how it was. So she was like, so you want to sing more, don't you? And I was like, yeah, I do. She said, okay, give me something. She said, come here. So she had a little napkin. She wrote, call me. So I was like, what just happened? You know, really, what? Because she knew, basically, one and a half songs I sang that I could sing, and that, okay, it would be nice if I could sing more. So she just, that was her thing. You want to sing more, don't you? I'm like, yeah. So she said, call me. And then from that point, I called her, and she said, I would reorganize my whole structure, whole band, and I'd like you to be the, to get the singers for me. So, sort of became a contractor immediately. First, I did held auditions in my apartment in Harlem.
Holy shit.
Yeah. And that's how I got, I pulled together, you know, all those girls that were with me, I pulled them. You know, some people I just called because, you know, like Lisa Fisher had, she had put me down from, you know, when I first hit the street running in New York. Mm-hmm. And I knew I wanted her to be the soprano, you know. So, and then Brenda White King has been really cool with me. Mm-hmm. And I needed one more, so I did some auditions for the third voice. I was me then. It was after. So anyway, I had to do auditions for several people.
Okay.
So I ended up bringing, Cindy came later when I had to press at Norma Jean, right, from Chic.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Yeah.
Holy shit.
Yeah.
So
voices.
I guess to go from that to being in an actual music video, because you're not wild about music videos. I mean, neither is Shaka, evidently. I never understood that about her. But you're not wild about music videos. And I look at Love of a Lifetime, because are you in any other videos of hers?
Yeah. This is My Night.
Okay.
I'm in that video too.
Okay.
But that's the only other official video. I'm of course on live videos with
sure,
her,
sure.
You know, but yeah, that the only the
music only MTV was, videos. Yeah.
Yeah, that was This Is My Night.
Wow. Okay. I need to look at that one again. Cause I haven't seen that one in a long time either. But okay, so we were talking about it. Me and Jarrett were talking about it. And we're just trying to figure out why everything else is happening. Like, it's yeah. Cocaine. It's cocaine, the video. Because
it really is.
Whoever is filming it, first of all, is taking huge risks. Like, they're getting close to these things and they're like under it, and it's like under fast shit. Motion. And it's like, what is happening?
It was a lot going on, yeah.
Okay. So confirm this. It looks like y'all showed up for one day.
Yep.
Or maybe two.
One day.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay. So y'all showed up for one day, shot this John in the same outfits y'all showed up in, went to maybe the carnival, and then it's like a sound stage. It looks like you guys went to like a venue, because there's like a background and it looks really...
Which probably looked like a sound stage to you. Because I remember there's a ramp. That ramp we went down, where we were like the dancers were in front of us and...
It was like a stage with lights around the bottom, and then the background was like the carnival. There's like a carnival background. It wasn't necessarily the carnival.
Yeah.
It just looks like it was a carnival. It doesn't matter. But I was
now I'm curious.
Right, rewatch it. But I think my biggest question, and
yes,
I love you, but what is this dress that you have on?
Oh shit, man! Let me tell you something. Let me tell you something. Damien, no. Let me. I should have wrote this shit down. Because I looked at the video again and I was like, what is it about this video that he wants me to remind myself of? Uh-huh. And I said, what the fuck am I wearing? I said, I bet he saw that. He didn't. So, and I said, I remember exactly what that dress is. And I'm going to tell you what that dress is. I'm going to tell you exactly what, because I was actually living with Shaka at the time. Because my man, she broke that shit up. Because it was a whole thing. But okay. Anyway, so that dress came from Laura Ashley, which was this little Upper West Side, you
yeah.
know.
Yeah.
Hoity-toity. And it was one of her, yeah, I know. Sort of, so it's like, you know, a certain type of gal wore that kind of
yes.
dress.
Yes.
Okay. And I didn't know what to wear. And so, Shaka, let's get you something. So it's literally Laura Ashley was on the corner of her building.
Okay.
So this is her dress now. Cause I couldn't
even see her in that. Like, I couldn't old grandma dress.
I don't
think
she ever wore that dress. I don't think, because it's like, if you took the jacket off, it was like a bustier kind of thing that went into the big skirt.
Okay. Little,
so that without the jacket, it looked all right. It's still like that. I would never. But she
it
was
looks
like
a best friend.
It looks like a best friend. So she was like, wear this dress. This is a little good. Because we're going to be on a carnival, and it's like, you know, a music park, and we're going to be all, you know, loud colors, and, you know, so. You know, so that we're just trying to look, I guess, matched it, the scene of the carnival. It was, Laura Ashley is not my thing.
No, I mean, it's very much, okay. But the, because they're not around anymore, right?
I don't even know.
Yeah, but I think that was, because when I saw you, I was like, oh, because I've seen the video before, but it had been a long time. And I remember you were in it.
Right.
However, it was one of those situations where I hadn't looked at it. And when you're reviewing it, you sort of look at it a little closer. And I'm looking at this, I'm like, okay, I love Shaka's dress and I love this hair on Shaka. And then we get to you and it's like the side ponytail and this.
Did you see the pink shoes?
I did. And this white floral dress.
It wasn't white. It was powder blue.
Oh.
With little pink flowers.
Debutante.
It was powder blue to match my innocence at the time.
Oh. Oh. Okay. Whatever. We'll go with that. So, I guess I didn't realize how deeply you were in it. Cause I mean, just a little history on my discovery of who Sandra St. Victor is, you know, as a kid, I mean, I was kind of never a kid, but as a kid, you know, I was listening to the Shaka Khan records and cause I didn't listen to Roy Ayers when I was a kid, but when I was a kid, I was listening to the Shaka Khan records and I'm like, this sounds like Shaka, but something's different. Cause it seems like it went from Whitney, Luther, and Sissy to you and everybody else. Because I did like, and I'm like, how do you go from Whitney, Luther, and Sissy to this nameless, you know what I mean? Like it was just sort of who is this woman? And so I would see your name pop up on the liner notes. And I'm like, what is a Sandra saying? And am I reading this whole thing? Cause I didn't know if it was just like, is this just Sandra and then it's somebody named St. Victor? So I was like,
people still don't know.
Right. Because how many times have you been called Sandra St. Vincent? Anyway, But it's like I kept reading it and then after album after album after album, it finally I was like, okay. And then I discovered Family Stand, and it's sort of I discovered Family Stand and Paula Abdul's second album at the same time.
Wow. Wow, so that had to be a real like whiplash kind of.
I'm like, wait.
those are two like two different universes.
Sure.
Of Family Stand. But if you think about it, Family Stand was also doing like Mickey Howard back then, you know what I mean?
And no, I discovered that later. But that was my first introduction to who you were. And I was like, I remember when I found out you were on MySpace and I was like, nope, I have access. I have to talk to this woman because she has been in my ears for so long and I had no clue. Like it's one of those, like when I listen to certain songs, like, Whatever You Want by Tina Turner. And like, when I listen to certain things, I'm like, okay. And now when I'm listening back to that stuff, I hear you, you know what I mean? Like, when I listen back to that stuff, I'm like, yeah, this is Sandra St. Victor. Absolutely. You know? And then I listen to other stuff. I'm like, yeah, this is Family Stand. You know what I mean? Like that stuff.
In
sort
retrospect,
of,
you can kind of hear it again. Yeah, I feel that.
Because your sounds are so distinctive that it's not like you sound like Soul to Soul or LaBouche or any other group that was pretty much coming out at the time.
Thank you for saying that.
It was. Oh, I love LaBouche. Don't do that.
I'm talking about Soul to Soul. Because people kept calling us Soul to Soul.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, you were out at the same time.
And they did a remix for Ghetto Heaven.
Did they? Mm-hmm. Who?
Well, Nelly Hooper and Jazzy.
Nelly Hooper. Okay. Yeah, Nelly Hooper's good at doing remixes. But I just remember that whole era of sort of black bands and Living Color. Right. I remember those bands coming out sort of boom, like at one time. Because that was very much Whitney Michael heavy. And that era, if it wasn't Whitney and Michael, people were like, who? It was, and I mean, we had, you know, Mariah and Toni Braxton, but it was very singular. It wasn't like in the 80s where you could have like 10 bands on the charts. It was like one artist dominated the chart.
when did Men Condition have their first hit? Do you remember?
That was like 93, 94.
Okay. Hey, come here. Okay.
So it was the early 90s. So y'all were still, they were still, yeah. Like it was Tony, Mint Condition, like the, something like
so
that.
So Pretty
like,
Brown Eyes was around 94.
93-ish, 93. End of 93. I don't give me lying. and don't read me in the comments because I don't care. But we the one thing that I remember was that all those black bands, the one thing that they didn't have that you and Living Color had was you weren't trying to be what the masses thought they needed. Does that make sense? Like, okay, no, so sure. like Soul to Soul in Europe is a completely different experience than Back to Life and Keep on Moving. You know what I mean? Like it's
right.
It's a complete, exactly. So it seems like right. When they crossed over, it just sort of became, they picked up Karen Wheeler and was like, okay, let's do,
right.
You know,
for sure. For sure.
You know, yeah. So with you guys though, it was like, nah, yeah, we'll do a couple. Right. We not yeah. Gonna make them our lead single, but we'll do a couple just to keep people happy. But for yeah. The most part, it was subversive and edgy and metal and I was into that. Like I was so into that. Like what happened between then? You don't have to tell me, but what happened between you working with Shaka for so long? Cause you still do sometimes, but it got lighter when you started doing sort of your own thing. Like you weren't on The Woman I Am project, The Woman I Am project as much yeah. As right. You were on Destiny and
yeah, basically, you know. When I started doing my own thing, you know, and stopped, you know, I was, before The Woman, was it Shaka and Shaka CK. Khan, I think, CK, you know, I was basically still only doing background work. I'm asking okay. Jeff who this artist is, Debbie, what? But so then, when I started doing, I actually started doing some demos with Peter and Jeff, and then that sort of evolved into the group, mm-hmm. You know. And I do recall very, very much the period where it's like, because there was a safety in just being a background singer.
Sure,
yeah, you know what I mean. And you know, there's also the safety of a paycheck. Mm-hmm. You know,
steady work.
So this hello, because she worked all the time back then.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
there was a safety in being with like my mentor and my best friend. You know, mm-hmm. Just basically hiding under her skirts all the time, and you know, just mm-hmm. being there. You know, but I do remember the day I decided I have to, you know, take this step and take this chance and start doing the. Focusing on me, you know, because that was what I was before, you know, before I moved
sure.
to New York.
Right.
So it was just, I just had to get back to that.
I think the authenticity of what you do versus somebody else that comes out of a camp like that, you know what I mean? Like when you see somebody that comes out of a camp like as massive as Shaka Khan's was in the mid to late 80s, yes. it can change your entire sort of DNA, right? So you can,
oh, for sure.
You'll go in as this person and then you'll go work with this person. You're with this person for years and years and years, and you'll come out sounding like them or trying to sound like them or making music like them. And I think that was the thing that I respected. Yes, it is in the same realm of what Shaka was doing, but her music was so poppy in the late 80s that I'm very surprised that you didn't come out doing what Vibology like yourself, you know what I mean? Like if you guys had come out doing Vibology, it would have sounded different. But if you guys
it's basically
had,
all us on the track anyway,
it's you anyway. it's us anyway, but, except yeah. For her saying horny horns, but the but I appreciate it. The fact that after, you know, of course, discovering all these things and listening back, I appreciated listening to it and like, you know what? This doesn't sound like the work she puts in on other people's projects. This sounds very personal and it's very authentic. It's very whoever Family Stan was at the time. And I appreciated that. Now, I lost track when they got the other girl. Who's the other girl?
Jackie McGee.
I lost track then.
Right. So that was when they, Jackie from Keith Sweat, Make It Last Forever.
Oh.
That's Jackie McGee.
Well, look at me learning things.
Look at you. What?
Look at you. I hate that
Are
song.
Are you but serious? I hate that song too. But listen, I love her tone.
Eats him on that track.
I love her tone, but I like her like on Connected and Butter, and she's got a little edge thing with Family Stan that she didn't have with on the last, but the girl can sing. The girl can sing.
Yeah.
I think it's just one of those things, you know.
I think because I'm biased and because I didn't hear you anymore, I was just sort of like.
Of course. I understand.
It's sort of like hearing Rufus and not hearing Chaka. It's like.
Listen, my favorite group in the world is Earth, Wind & Fire, and I refuse to go see them after Mari stopped, touring with them. I couldn't.
Yeah, I don't know who's. They have almost a completely new band, other than just
the three of them. The three.
Yeah, so but well, if two.
Three. It's Verdine, Philip, and then what's his face?
Right.
He was there all along too. So it's
Okay. Yeah. I've definitely lost track of that, but it's sort of like seeing the Temptations now.
Hello. It's like that ain't no Temptations.
Now they sound amazing, and I really like the music. So great. I would never go see them live.
No, ain't no Temptation.
Who is
that? That's the Temptation Experience.
Right.
That's what that is. That's the Temptation Experience.
But it's the same thing. Like if I was going to New York or anything like that, and they were like, "Oh, Family Stan is playing," as much as I love Jeff, that's my unk. I love Jeff. So I would definitely go, but I would be like, I would want him and Peter just to sing. Cause whoever else they would have up there, I'd be like,
Right. It's not
it could be somebody, it could be a beast too. It could be Lettucey. They could have grabbed.
Right.
They could have grabbed somebody.
Could've been anybody wanted.
But yeah, this is what I'm saying. Like they could grab anybody and I would still be like, but.
Yeah,
it doesn't
the
rock the same.
It's about the thing that it's like, was it Dance with the One That Brung You kind of thing? It's that vibe, It's like, that's what I got into. That's the sound you want. And
right.
It's not even a personal thing against anybody. It's just, you dig something, you dig what that is. And,
yeah.
Other things that are different and good in another way. It's just a different thing.
So fast forward, because we're not gonna do this whole. Because if we talked about your career, girl, we'd be here for like an hour, and I don't have that kind of time. So fast forward, we gonna scoop past Mac Diva Saves the World, because everybody knows you about the Mac Diva Saves the World. Everybody knows that.
Okay.
The projects you're doing now as Sandra St. Victor feel very, what's the word? Not, I don't want to say personal again, but they feel like pet projects. Like it's something that is like, you know what? I don't necessarily need to do this. Cause I mean, the industry has changed so much that putting out an album now is not as important as it used to be. However, in order to get gigs, you have to remain relevant, which means you have to continue to make music, which means you have to keep remaking, content. And it's sort of just a revolving door of, I gotta go in to record this album that nobody's gonna buy to make sure that I get gigs that I might get, but it has to be music that the venues are gonna like enough to book me. So I think what I respect about you so much is that you're like, you know what? I'm still gonna do this. Cause Sandra St. Victor could easily find somebody to work with. I mean, cause don't get me wrong, I love Mark DeClavlo. Like
Mark is bad.
The music that he makes is so innovative and
it's art. It's art.
Yeah. It's art. It can get a little complicated, sort of like Monk in the beginning there.
You know, where, I love that. Like,
I know. I want to sing
over them chords.
Baby, listen. But I think a Sandra St. Victor could find somebody that would be like, hell yeah. Like, you could work with the Roots easily. You know what I mean? Like, they would love to have you working with them. I think they would benefit more than you. You know what I mean? Like, it would be...
Well, it would certainly open me up to folks that don't, that think I'm Victor or think I'm Vincent. Or,
sure,
you know?
Sure.
So, I mean, you know, it could definitely open up some more avenues. I guess at this moment, I feel like... I want to spend my creative time doing something that is not to keep me relevant, but sure. for me to stay relevant to me. You know, it's about my own relevance to myself. Okay, uh-huh. It's like, and that means I have to do stuff that comes from that space that yeah. we are aware of, you know.
Sure.
If it doesn't come from that space, then actually it's harder for me. It's harder for me to sing stuff that I don't feel, you know.
Yeah.
A lot of people you know, I mean, people always ask me to feature on something. I say, send it to me here. And 9 times out of 10, I say no, because it's like, I just can't do that, you know. It's like, even for like good friends, but you know, there's somebody, Jeff called me, I've seen whatever Jeff had. Jeff, it's never sure. whack. Okay. You send me something, it's never whack. You know, but you have not sent me anything whack. You may have whack shit, you just never sent it to me. So, you know, we all got some questionable shit up in here. You know,
sure, sure. You know,
that, oh my God, my dog just farted. I hate when you do that. Can you not? Sorry, that was too much of
Stop feeding your dog shit that's going to make
Go
it fart.
Go over there. Go over there with that. Jesus.
Okay. But anywho. I think my point, you know, absolutely. What do you, like, how do you feel about if somebody, like, I don't know, if, I mean, this is wild. But if Beyonce calls a Sandra St. Victor and says, I just discovered you, I'm in love yeah. with you, can I send you something? That, like, would your answer be the same with her for that check money? Because listen, I am not I am not opposed to selling this puss for a little change.
Listen.
So I'm just trying to understand where you stand on actually, like, doing the work for the art of it. Because Shaka just did an interview, and did you see this interview? Okay, so she just did an interview with Lunel, and I personally thought she protested a little too much, but she was just talking about how she's not interested in working with women anymore. As far as like doing duets or anything, and she just did a duet with Ariana Grande for the for the you know
Donna
for
Allen.
For the okay Donna Allen for the soundtrack for the new Charlie's Angels movie. They just did a song together on that soundtrack. Now, as people were interviewing Shaka during the promo for that project, she was very anti. She was just very, oh, well, we're not gonna change the world. It's just a little fun song to do. Let me turn my mic down. It's just a little fun song to do and whatever. You know what I mean? Like, she was very
anti. Yeah.
Yeah, she was. But then at the same time, during this interview with Lunel, she was just sort of like, oh no, fuck her, she's fine. She can do whatever she wanna do. And it's just sort of like, but didn't you just
Who Ariana could be do what she wanted to do?
Yeah, that's what shocked. She was like, I don't, if you want to sing by yourself or whatever, say what you got to say by yourself. You ain't got to say it with me. And it's very, that is like, okay, well, oh, fuck my drag then, because Now, I remember right. you worked with Mary J. Blige. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, right.
You start going back and you don't want to pull cards on her because she shot God, but.
Right. See, had I been interviewing her, but okay.
But see what I'm saying? This is what I'm saying. Like, so how do you feel about, because she's at an age now where she can do that. She's at a point in her career where she can do that. But she just did it. It would have been different if it was 10 years ago.
Right.
He just did it and then is protesting about, no, I don't need to do that no more. It's like, but, so was it for the money?
Well, I don't really know what made her do the Ariana Grande thing. I haven't hollered at about that. But I will. but I do know she's in a place right now, certainly since the whole lockdown and stuff.
Sure.
Where she's like, she really don't want to do shit that she don't want to do no more. That's she's word. always not wanted to do shit she don't want to do. But she's always had business focus. She got, you know, family. And I mean, she listens to business people when they say this will be good for you and that.
Yeah.
And sometimes it is, and sometimes I disagree. But, you know, I'm not her manager. But right now, she really ain't feeling doing shit that, you know, ain't sitting right with her. I've seen her through many, many different phases. This particular phase is new, okay? Because I've seen her go through cycles and stuff, but this is a new one. This is a wholly different one. For me, if Beyonce called, hell yeah, I'm gonna do it. And again, shit, the coins is lovely, but I actually really like Beyonce, and I know a lot of people don't, but I think Beyonce is very fucking talented.
Yeah.
I really like the songs she writes. I think she's an incredible entertainer. And I would love to be down because she makes statements, and I like to make statements.
Very much now. That's very much her now.
Right. Now, she called me when she was doing Single Ladies. Hell no. But,
this is what I'm saying.
I can't, you know.
Well, she wouldn't have had you in the video. Yeah, I'm just saying. Would you have turned down going on tour with her if she asked you to go on tour with her?
Now or during Single Ladies?
During any phase of the Beyonce experience, would you have turned her down?
Okay, I'm not gonna say no, and I'm not gonna say, but listen, Damien, I thought about this the other day, because somebody offered me a substantial sum of money to do a song that I thought was straight trash.
Okay.
And I ain't gonna call them nice, so that's not nice. I ain't that kind of people.
But didn't you just anyway, though?
I didn't. No, anyway, song was trash. But so I said to myself, you know, bitch.
Right.
You told your crazy ass told Prince to fuck off because that song was trash and that you didn't want to do. I told Prince a song was trash and that I'm not doing it. I know, and I still, I still think that was the right move.
Oh.
I do. I still think that was the right move because if
I feel like you struggle with that.
I do. You know why I do? Because he's gone.
Sure.
Because he's gone. Had he still been around, I would still feel like, that's all right, I'm going to go one day. You know what?
When
I
see him, you know. Any day
that
now.
That was always there. Mm-hmm. But now that he's gone, I'm like, God, oh, man.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I still got the joint. You know, he still, you know, used several of my songs. But,
sure.
Yeah. You know,
I will put the list here.
You know, okay, cool.
So. I'm not putting that list there.
But had I done the song with those lyrics, would I sleep well at night? Listen, didn't I tell you the lyrics that I remember of that song? The lyrics to the specific song that I'm thinking about was, you be the car, I be the gas, you be the water, I be the grass. I'm like, motherfucker, do you? Sorry, Damien. You're gonna have to come to me. It was a song. He never released it, but he wanted me to sing that song. And I'm like, sir.
When was this? That sounds very 80s Prince. When was this?
No, this was 90s. This was 96?
Okay. Yep. He was still in his bag. He was still in his bag then.
Rosie Gaines was singing the demo, you know?
Oh.
And, yeah. And, sounded great, you know, Rosie.
Sure.
But I'm like,
and we miss Rosie, by the way. We don't know what's going on with her.
But it's happening with Rosie. I know she's going through it, and her daughter's, yeah. You know. But
anyway. So I mean, I guess that answers my question, because if you will turn down Prince, Prince is still like, people are still like trying to cover his music now, especially now, you know, they're like, oh, I want to cover the song, and his estate is like, nah, bitch. So it's like, in order for Prince's estate to be so, especially Prince when he was alive, of course, when he was living, and he was just talking, just, I work with people that put in the work, you know, he was always that guy. So, and he makes people work. Like, you would see his band on stage, it was like, God damn, like, what was this rehearsal like?
But, days long.
Yeah. But I think of that, and then you say shit like, I turned down a Brit song, and I'm sitting here like, my butt cheeks do this, because I'm like, you want me to sing what? You could have told me to sing Mary Had a Little Lamb. I would have been on that track. I would have been Prince featuring Damian Nova. Yes, I'm here.
Whatever. But see, the thing is, I put it like this: had he asked, like you said, if Beyonce asked me to go on tour with her, I'd probably do that, because I like her artistry enough to. Mm-hmm. I would go on tour with Prince and sing all. You know, he wouldn't even sing Head at the end.
Yeah, after a while, he stopped singing a lot of those songs. Yeah,
but you know. Would I want the song that he sent me? This is for my project, for my album.
Oh.
That was called Sanctuary. He wanted me to sing.
Yes.
You see, this is who represent me. This is not some background shit. He was giving that song to me to sing. I'm like,
and Sanctuary is a lot of album, by the way.
Okay. Like
that's a lot of goddamn songs.
So, back in them days, yeah.
Yeah, so it's for you to have like a 25 deep album,
right,
and then reject a Prince song. It just
I know.
If he it still makes gone, my eyes water. So
I it really hit me when he left. It really hit me when he left. It just hit me. I was like, God, oh man. Come on, son.
I think that hits me, the fact that I'll never meet him. I think that sort of bothers me a little bit, but I remember I was at a CD store. I was going to just buy CDs, and this was a CD store that sold like obscure stuff and classical music, and that was pretty much it. Like, it was just like obscure stuff and classical music.
Okay.
And I happened across Gemini just sitting there by itself. You didn't have, they didn't have Mac Diva, they didn't have any Family Stand.
Gemini. Interesting.
And I was like, the fuck? Like, it was just sort of like, what the fuck did she put on a new album? Like,
what city? Where? In Ohio? Where were you? I'm wondering, was that the version
what year
of
was
Gemini?
That? Wait a minute, what year was that?
Well, so I pressed up my the first copies of that album, and that was 2000. I pressed up those. So the first, like, you know, maybe 5,000 or so. It must have been New York, because I had I sent them to record stores myself. And then expansion in the UK put it out worldwide. Yeah. So it was
man, okay. So I'm not gonna go into every song, because if I did, we'd be here all day. Because Mac D, yeah, we could do this over sake one day. But the Mac Diva album is a very complete record, right? So it's from start to finish. It sounds very much of the time that it came out.
It is. It was.
Very D'Angelo, very Erykah Badu. It has all those sort of elements to it.
Record company.
Mm-hmm. Oh, sure. Gemini, however, shook me. It was sort of like, yeah, no, I know. Because I remember when I heard you open it with Slipping in the Darkness, I was like, What?
What is she doing?
Where are we going? Where? And then if you loved yourself more, I mean, it sort of.
Yeah.
So if you do not have Gemini both sides, is it available on digital? Is it?
Yeah. Still? Oh yeah.
Okay. So if you don't have Gemini both sides, I implore you, as a music fan, if you're on my page, you're a music fan. But if I implore you to buy this project, Mac Diva Saves the World is a standard. Don't get me wrong. But no, Gemini both sides is,
like you said, it's personal.
Garrett. Like I was just, and I told you like at the time, like I was going through some stuff and we talked about it on MySpace. Yeah. And he's cool, like was the one that grabbed me and I was like, okay, nope, I gotta talk to this lady.
I will never forget. I was like, who is this motherfucker? Cause who told me about Shelter? Somebody told me, you should hear this brother saying Shelter. Who told me that?
I sang Shelter? I did? I don't remember that one.
I do.
Okay.
Yo, son, this is what I was like, what the fuck? I remember Tom sending it to people. Listen to them. You sang it a cappella.
Okay.
Very high. It was just like, I was like, damn, he sound better than me. And then I was like,
listen, you if don't it wasn't remember, me,
it was
it
you.
Me,
it was you.
It was you. Put your name in the comments because I don't remember doing that.
It was so you, and I bet it's
pre rehab.
I bet I could pre rehab.
I don't remember that.
That is crazy. And I'm the one with the bad memory of the two of us.
Hey, I didn't say I didn't. I just said you do. I remember just your whole journey with Family Stan and Shaka and Bill Withers. I mean, come on, like
miss him. God.
Yeah, like so my brain has all your information. There are certain things I don't know, like I didn't know. Yeah, you don't want me to hate you ever. But the funny thing is that the people you surround yourself with, like the other singers you surround yourself with, yeah, are other vocalists and artists that I respect so much and would sell my mother's soul to sing with.
I feel you.
Like Lisa Fisher and
Lisa. I think it's Lisa, yes. Oh,
she makes my back hurt. Like I listen to her, I'm like,
too.
Why do you sound like this?
God, I love her so much. Oh, I love me so, Lisa.
It's ridiculous. And she's, I mean, it's ridiculous. And Lettucey is ridiculous. And Selena Johnson is ridiculous. And like, yeah, it's just
Selena's bad.
People that I've seen you around.
Lisa's my wife, though. Oh, I mean, I said it here. Shocking, man. Shocking my wife. Shocking my bestie. Anyway, but Lisa's my,
second wife.
These is my bitches.
Oh, she's your bottom bitch.
We just my bottom bitch, and then we got my we each other's bitches.
Oh, I love that lady.
I love Lisa.
And she's so gracious and honest.
She's a beauty. A beauty. Like when she calls, like when we're doing messages, and you do the little voice, you know, so instead of typing, you do voice message. I say that again. Because I want to hear it again. Because even when she talks.
Oh, wow.
I'm saving this because I want to hear you talk. It's just, you have a soothing voice. Say that again so I can say it.
Yeah, I mean, that Lisa Fisher album, because I think we are deprived of a Lisa Fisher project right now.
Seriously.
But that the only album that we have of hers, it's like, it just sounds like she's having sex in this dude. Like every note,
every song, every
drips. Yeah. It just drips, baby. And I'm like, oh, all alone. Oh.
You go.
Oh. I can't. She makes me scream.
Oh my God, I love her.
I'm just gonna hand list these hoes. So the sound of your voice is very much akin to, and this is me being blackety black. is very akin to what a lot of these white girls want to sound like, or what they think a black voice sounds like. So when you hear...
Don't say Taylor Dane. Go ahead, say Taylor Dane. Because I've had so many people tell me, I thought that was you, and I found it was Taylor Dane.
When you hear Taylor Dane, and to be frank, not these days, but when you hear Taylor Dane or Anastasia or Lisa Stansfield or even Miley Cyrus now, Miley Cyrus has this sound in her throat.
Oh, where, I saw that when she's doing the Blondie song, right?
Yeah, and she's doing what a lot of them think black women are supposed to sound like instead of just sounding like themselves. Now, there are some people I know that, like Anastasia, grew up listening to nothing but black music. So that's why she sounds that way. But right. there are others that it's like, oh, well, the label will tell them you need to sound like Tina Turner. Mm-hmm. So
then they try to get it just be sounds more nasally.
Yeah.
It's more nasal than tone.
And there are a couple of them that do it well, like Nika Costa does it fantastically.
Yes.
But yeah, that's just her voice. You know what I mean? Like that I don't feel like she's trying to sound like anything. So
she's a natural.
Do you feel, as a person who is definitely the leader of the pack, one of the leaders of the pack when it comes to what we know now as Afropunk? And what we know now as sort of alternative R&B and alternative soul and rock and roll, basically. Do you feel slighted in any way? Because I do. When I listen to them and I hear you come out of their mouth, I'm like, bitch. And that bothers me. It does. So do you feel any, like when you hear somebody, do you ever feel that way? Do you ever feel like, that ain't cool?
You know what? No. I mean, I just, I think I've always, I was gonna say I lack ambition or something.
Oh.
But maybe I do, but that's not really what it is. It's more that I do feel like I have something to say and something to contribute. And I would love it if what I got to say was heard by more people. Mm. And what I have to contributed, you know, because I would use my platform so hard right now to, you know, with what's going on.
Yeah.
You know, with everything.
And we'll get to that in a minute.
You know, so, but I don't, because I feel like we all like a sort of amalgamation of everything we've ever listened to. And
ain't nothing new under the sun.
Yeah. Not a damn thing. So I don't fault nobody because I know for sure, like when I started doing Family Stand, like you, because you said it exactly correct. After working with Shaka for so many years, you know, you end up, I mean, a lot of me changed. You know, when I first got with Shaka, I was like more a mixture of Maurice White and Sarah Vaughan.
Oh, wow. Okay. No, I hear that.
Okay. Right. And that's still in there. But then with Shaka, you have to sound like her because she did all her backgrounds. So I had to tell Peter and Jeff in the studio, okay, when I sound too much like Shaka, pull my coattail.
Yeah.
And so I asked them to make sure because I just, you know, stopped doing the Shaka thing. Now I'm trying to find me again. Mm-hmm. So that was in there. And actually I always believe that if anything else has been like almost a curse because it's only one Shaka Khan, ain't gonna never be another Shaka Khan.
Yeah.
Melissa Morgan, Tony, who just passed from Jamaica Funk.
Oh yeah, yeah.
Brown, I can't think of baby name. Vesta.
Vesta, yeah.
Melissa Morgan. I mean, all them sisters that sound like Shaka, that you can only get so far when you sound like Shaka because we got Shaka.
Yeah.
Can't have Shaka.
Yep.
So nobody trying. So I don't want to be that, and I feel like I feel like my solo career has been like boxed into that's one of the Shaka girls.
Sure.
So then
I think Rahsaan Patterson deals with that. Yeah.
Definitely, as well.
Yeah.
You know, so you get boxed into that, and where are you going to go when you got the queen of it all right there?
Sure.
You know, so I don't feel funny. I do feel like, you know, there have been some bumps and obstacles that putting my path that would not have been put in a white singer's path.
Sure.
Sounding sure. like me. Mm-hmm. Which that has proven true. Okay.
Word. So,
word. Okay.
And I see those girls and I listen to a couple of them mainly because it sounds like you. I don't really like, and it's funny because that's the voice I gravitate towards. I love Tina Turner. I love Syeda yeah. Garrett. You know what I mean? Yeah. I love those girls that sound like that because yeah. it's important to hear other Black girls and other Black women sound like something else other yes. than doing the 1,000 note riffs. Even though exactly. y'all do them, don't get, and I keep trying to tell people, like, don't get cute. If Sandra right. St. Victor wants to do a 1,000 note riff, she yeah, will. She will. Yeah. I've heard it.
Pete and Jeffy tell me, okay, do that simpler. They used to shut me out because I've been like, and they were like, oh, chill, okay. Melody.
And I'm going to intercut you doing the intro to FMAOcity because the intro to that is just.
Or Cosmos.
Cosmos, that's it. I'm going to intercut Cosmos because.
Oh, I love that intro.
What the hell, intro. Man? What the intro. Hell? And I really tried it.
Rasan loves that song. He loves that. Him and Layla, that's their jam.
Layla Hathaway makes me want to vomit. It's ridiculous.
She's one of a kind. That bitch is.
There's no reason.
She is unreal.
It doesn't make sense.
She's unreal.
She is otherworldly. And I always forget her, but it's like when I think about it, it's like, oh no. And because she's right in my wheelhouse, sometimes like I can just blast out a Layla Hathaway song and sing with her. And I love being able to do that.
I know, right?
Because who doesn't want to sing with Layla Hathaway?
Okay, if you but can.
If you can sing along.
You a bad motherfucker to sing along with Layla Hathaway.
Oh, not on everything, honey. But on some of them songs, but yeah, so.
Damn, I do have some dope friends. God,
you
man,
do.
That girl.
You oh, do.
She, I love her too, man.
That's what I'm saying. Sister. Like you have the stable of girls that sister, everybody man. Wants to be. Like nobody, like people want to be man. Y'all. Do you understand that? Like people want to be y'all. Like,
not me. I know they want to be like Chaka.
No.
But I love these girls so much because of their integrity to yeah. art.
Sure.
And also because they're just good people and a good, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
They solid friends. Solid friends, you know. But their integrity to art matters
yeah.
so much to me. So much.
So let's talk about this new album right quick.
Which one?
Which one?
I got a couple of them.
Okay. We have a new Family Stand album coming out. What's the name of this then?
Evolve.
Okay, so Evolve has the first single dropped and it was a fuck you to pretty much America. talk about the process right now with y'all being grown ass people and sort of living hemispheres apart.
For real.
Because I, you know, I'm in a band and it's hard as hell trying to get together and create and.
Yeah, it is.
Even well, before you know. COVID, like it was hard. So,
oh yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, of course it's worse now. But I live in the Netherlands. Peter lives in LA. Jeff lives in New York. So
Jesus.
Yeah. So it's fortunately we're all able to, you know, record ourselves at home.
Sure.
You know, we send files back and forth and, mm-hmm. you know, make notes and make changes and blah blah blah. And then it eventually all comes down to mix, obviously, because
yeah.
you know, you got to make that shit sound cohesive. Like
y'all sound recording. Like you're in the same room. Yeah.
You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So, you know, Jeff does a great job at that. Jeff always makes me sound better than I sound. And so I love what he does, you know, with my voice. I really do. He's amazing. I'm like, damn, that sounds good. Like, but it just makes it harder, because back in the day, we used to be able to, well, we'd be able to create and write in the room together. Mm-hmm. You know, yeah. I remember, you know, just and making jokes and.
Yeah,
and the joke would turn into a song.
I mean,
that,
yeah,
and that has happened several times, and those songs were hits. Usually, the ones that started as jokes were the hits. So you know, so not being in that in their direct, you know, in that cipher with them consistently, you know, it makes it harder to actually write the songs.
Sure.
You know, the way we did before.
Yeah.
The way we did. We can still write, you know, okay, send me this track and I'll come up with this part, you come with that part, that sort of thing. But you know, it's not the same. It's not the same.
Yeah, creating in the same room together, you create that energy, and sometimes it can change the course of the project. And
Seriously.
It really does make a world of difference, but this is the era of, this is the digital age, so you sort of have to make do with.
Right.
What you can with, it's impossible to, oh, I'm going to fly there tonight. I'm going to fly there. You're going to fly here tomorrow. We're going to, you know, unless you're going to just say, hey, let's work on this project. Let's get a cabin somewhere.
Right.
And just fuck the world for about a month and just record this album. You know, that's really the only way to do it right now.
That's how I did Oya's Daughter, actually.
Okay. Yeah. So, well, you know what? And it sounds like.
I went to a cabin in the woods for a month.
Left to your own devices.
I was. I should have had some supervision, but I should have. But I was like, mwah.
Yeah.
It's just me for a month. Mwah.
So you said we're going to get something else. So here's my thing. My favorite, even though I love Gemini Both Sides, I think my still right now, my favorite project is the EP that you put out.
At MySpheres?
At MySpheres. It's still really? My favorite project. Yeah. It rubs amazing. Me in all the ways I needed to. The one that you were selling only at your shows, the
Hand Delivered.
Those are my two. Pretty much the ones that are in constant rotation. I haven't really looked for it again, but I need to download some of those songs again, because I lost some of them when my computer was stolen. But I definitely need to re-download, you know, Atmospheres. But you know I love Atmospheres. Like, I'll send you something where I'm singing Atmospheres, because it's my project. I fucking love that album. And I bought the remix.
Oh, you bought the remix too. Yeah.
Oh.
They were those good.
Remixes?
They were good.
Oh my God.
Sold, and oh my God, they get some killer remixes, and the dude from Foreign Exchange, Nick
yeah.
They did some killer remixes, man.
It's great. It's a great project. So are you doing something solo with right now?
Yeah, or? Well, with that's the you know, the Mark Batson project that.
Oh.
Yeah. Huh? Yeah, we're gonna put it out. But Mark, you know, Mark is, well, he's genius at large, basically, but he's basically gonna be the person to put it in a position he wants to put it in, to put it out, right?
Okay.
The music is done. But, you know, he's got his own situation going on, and we want it to come out, we just don't want to just put it online.
Okay.
So it's going to go through this new situation that he has happening that I can't really speak on, because I don't want to state something or preempt announce
his thing. His thing.
Yeah, so it's this thing is happening, and Mark Batson is, my God. I mean, you know.
So is this the project with yourself on it and?
Just me.
The song. The song. Is that Mark Batson? Yourself?
Yourself. No. All of no. Yourself. That's Josh Milan. The Mark Josh Batson. Josh Milan. Which is also another bad dude, Gemini. This is Beautifully Dark.
Okay.
Okay. So that's the Mark Batson. You haven't heard any of Beautifully
Dark? I haven't. I have not.
I think I told you a year ago I'm going to send you that record, and I think I forgot.
Oh, that. But, duh. She forgot something, y'all.
Every now and then something slips my mind. So,
but no, I had no clue. Like, I don't remember.
Mark Basson. Okay, you know who Mark Basson is?
Yeah, sure.
Okay, right. So, it's the album is all he and I.
Oh, okay.
It's the whole album of Mark and Sandra. So it's just a beautiful album called Beautifully Dark.
I'm hyped. How are you gonna get me hyped for something that you don't even know when it's coming out? I hate you.
I know.
I need music. I hate everything that's out right now, except for Lettucey's project. Lettucey's project is really good.
Oh, but I gotta get that.
No, it's good. It's really good.
I will sing you the new Family Stand and the new the Beautifully Dark album.
Look at me getting shit.
Look at you getting things. It's your birthday, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, sure.
Because I want to be 40 more again. But I'm going to tell you something. I'm very upset. when I'm in a room full of brown people that claim to be music heads and they don't know who Sandra St. Victor is. That bothers me because I'm like, not only because she's my friend, but because of her contribution to music, period. Like there's songs that, of course, they're like B-sides or they'll be deep in the album. Like Chaka Khan redid I'll Never Open My Legs Again. To hear Chaka Khan sing it was jarring. I'm gonna be honest. Like, cause when I heard her sing it, I was like, ah! But when you hear Sandra's version, because it's on Sanctuary, right? And it's on the
Sanctuary, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's on
I put on Bandcamp.
Bandcamp. Yeah, it's on your Bandcamp. Yeah. And I'll put the link down below for her Bandcamp.
Yeah.
Cool. To hear Chaka's, you know,
it's different.
Mm-hmm. That's an understatement. Yours is grimier, it's nastier, it's fuck you and your dick.
It's got more rock it's on that. It. So yeah. Fuck you and your dick, yes.
Right, it's that. Where Chaka's is definitely more palatable, but you very much hear the influence of both ladies in both versions of it. Like I hear Chaka in your
for
version,
sure.
I hear her I hear you in her version. Even with that really interesting, I'm gonna say interesting. Track that she's singing over. I'm sorry, it's whack. And I love Prince, but that track.
We love him. We have.
What happened there?
I was just very happy that I had Larry Graham was playing. Larry Graham has played bass on a song I wrote, so I'm very happy. I love that song because of that. Larry Graham's playing bass on a song I wrote. Larry Graham's playing bass on a song I wrote. That's what I'm saying to him, right? Because I'm a bass hoe, so it's like, yeah, I'm a real bass hoe. Like,
yeah.
So, oh my God, Larry.
So again, like the vastness of your career cannot be understated. Black folks appreciate
Damien.
You, and we love you, and we cherish you, and we're gonna cherish you while you alive. And we go.
Thank you.
We gonna give you your flowers while you alive, and that's why I wanted to do this interview. Not only because I just watched that Chaka Khan video, which was a video, and I had
laughing at my dress.
I had more questions about the video per se,
but
I'm gonna leave it.
What?
No, because I don't. It gets a little bit more personal. So we're gonna close it out because we could go all day, and I'm gonna have to edit this whole down because this is an hour and 12 minutes in. But I'm I appreciate
you
so much.
We'll stay on and keep chatting.
Yo, I appreciate you so much, but I'm excited. I'm excited for the new music. I hope you do another video for something. Cause I mean, you're not a video girl and this is the era of making a video and you could get a green screen and just stand in front of that hole and have somebody edit it. That's what I'm saying. Like, just make something.
I like to play. Listen, I do spend time fidgeting around with Filmora 9.
Okay.
So like the little video for the Family Stand songs, Song for Michelle. I did that.
Yeah, Song for Michelle. Yeah, okay.
I did that video myself, you know,
okay.
Just messing around. You know, I plays around.
check out the Family Stands. Are y'all doing Twitter?
Yeah, Family Stand is on Twitter. I think we're the, what's it called? The official,
Family Stand.
The official fam stand or something.
I'm gonna need you to know. Okay, I'll put it in the description. I'll find it and I'll put it in the description. And their Instagram, I think it's just the Family Stand, isn't it?
I accidentally deleted the Instagram Family Stand.
That's why I can't find it. I was trying to find it. That's why I can't find it. And that other group is still up.
So we couldn't be the Family Stand. We couldn't be the Family Stand.
There is another The Family Stand, and they.
It's so funny. That is so funny. It's not. Is it a group? I don't even know what that is.
I don't know what they are. It's almost like a. It's like an art collective.
It looks like that. Yeah. I don't get it.
But yeah. So check out their Instagram if we ever find it, or if they ever recreate it.
I have to recreate it.
But find Sandra St. Victor. I mean, VJ Free Smith is on it. Peter Lord ain't on shit. He's on Facebook and he don't
we
even
are
be
his
on that.
Eyes. We are his eyes and ears. Right. It.
So check out V. Jeffrey Smith on Facebook and Sandra St. Victor on Facebook and wherever else you can find them or whatever you're on. Okay. Thank you again for joining. Okay. Thank you again for joining me here on Penny Candy Interviews. Oh my God. Thank you for joining me again on Penny Candy Interviews. I'm your host, Damian Nova. Like, comment, subscribe, and share. I will have my Patreon up and running soon so that you can support the channel. Peace out. Penny Candy.